Are you emailing or what?
Yeah, I will email it.
My email is Bob over in.
Okay, let me know when everyone has it.
Sure.
Let's debate.
When I was 10 years old, I felt I totally had to work harder than everyone around me, not because of who I was, because of who the world was seeming to be. I was taught that my body is an obstacle, something to overcome in sixth grade. My path they found I was Korean. They called me, for weeks. When I told people I'm Mexican, they asked me if I'm sure. They say I thought you were Asian, but it's impossible to be old. They asked me why I don't speak Spanish. That way you teach me Spanish. Can't look, I was taught that my language was something to be ashamed of. Call me green enough, white enough, not Asian enough, not Mexican enough, not enough. All my identity checking off boxes to make you comfortable. My entire life success has been dictated by my ability to shed the skin I was born in chameleon, hoping to pass, even though I've been told to push my identity to the side for my entire life. Identity is all I have. It's the only thing that keeps me whole. It's separate my experience, my advocacy for my experience would be submit to the fraction of the seed, the body that Charles Wade has suffered for centuries. I rejected traditional educational research that constructs restrictive bodies and knowledge, a devalue minority viewpoints, the Chicano feminist epistemology of racist narratives, and the experience of Mexican American women as a way to add meaning to data and break down boundaries of knowledge. The affirmative is a research project made to break down dialogic boundaries and create new ways of education through the lived experience of Chicano women to directly involve my marginalized voices in the research process for all 98. Women education research is conducted and contributes significantly to what's considered legitimate body and knowledge of Chicano epistemology is behind Chicano. Chicano is dedicated to unique viewpoints that can bridle cultural intuition. This comes from including two Chicano participants in the new methodology of which to research in Chicano communities. Researchers just deconstruct the epistemology of the participants in the databases for the entire project and bring meaning to the data based on the interpretive process. This means that any evaluation of data or empirics must be held through a narrative viewpoint as a prerequisite to engaging in the post-fiat world. Other attempts to reproduce strategies of educational research that justify the oppression of marginalized groups and create bad legal scholarship. Therefore, the methodology of the affirmative is to engage in the legal storytelling movement through the use of personal narratives and critical Latina scholarship to radically embrace my story within a hostile space as a survival strategy and attempt to keep myself from being ripped apart by statistics that don't know who I am. I try to put percentages in the place of my body. I try to use weighing mechanisms to make my people's suffering acceptable. Rebellious legal practice allows us to create strategies of resistance that are informed by the experience of the oppressed Miranda 16. Using narrative as a technique to apply rational sensibility to rebellious practice to larger forces, political mobilization, and social movements, the concepts of racism have direct, practical, inescapable, and immediate relevance. Even people of color and not all practitioners, we can possibly walk away from racism the way the white progressives can. I extend the discussion of racism from a working class aesthetic to an active or creative form of resistance and oppression subordinated in the U.S. transnationally. The 1AC is a performance of Latina critical analysis of U.S. hegemony, which is interplayed within the production of racism and capitalism within the criminal justice system. The app is a fundamental break from the old standards of criminal justice. We are as a result of neoliberal logic prioritize competent analysis of the lives of real people. That's why the opposition neoliberalism must be grounded in the practice of lived experience. Voting affirmative is to say that you ethically orient yourself towards the livelihood of the brown and black body over that of hegemonic institutions which punish them. Doing so requires to reject plea bargaining French 16. The ideological rationalization of human beings that home economics leads to confronting judicial problems with cost-benefit analysis provides jurisprudential legitimization for plea bargaining. The liberal marginalization of desires by race, ethnicity, class, intersectoral orientation, immigration status, intellectual ability manifest in orchestrated policies designed to punish. Law of instrumentalized by cultural hegemonic neoliberal ideology provides a jurisdictional rationalization for the abrogation of constitutionally protected rights when prosecuting defense attorneys and judges receive are the most efficient way to dispose of ever-increasing case with the state of attachment is imposed to generate a market-rationalized use for formal rights protection. Systematic and visionary reform is key. Punitive militarization is a result of legitimized mass incarceration. A whole system of prison that they currently are has created a racialized neoliberalism, the bulldozing of public policy in favor of private policing, Drew 16. Hyper-punitive political culture has legitimated neoliberal cruelty to fuel racism, mass incarceration, through the killing of black youth, testifies to domestic them. I'll have millions of effective prisons each year, distinct between war and civil society. The police function as sole. Their shared responsibilities are replaced by fear of the public safety because of finding increasing as the police matter. Politics is now an extension of the culture of war. And plea bargaining is the law. The largest cause of over criminalization has inverted the criminal justice system, forcing it to backfire, making police and conviction and racism inevitable and massive. Sabisco 9. The plea bargaining system is responsible for both in large part the American prison population as well as a disproportionately large number of minorities who make up that population. There's every reason that increasing incarceration has actually brought back by creating a norm of prison acceptance rather than deterring crime. The institution of plea bargaining that has refueled the growth of populations as well as the demographic disparity. Only the narration of the affirmative respects the possibility of acquittal without accepting a plea. The use of narratives of the prison system expands the role of argumentation through the creative the application of testing and evidence in motive to stage motive theme productive and character in lieu of merely plot. Narrative creates space for a chronicle self-expression which challenges dominant theory that evidence is capable of speaking for itself. Holland 09. Narrative lawyering just how narrative sensibility can elevate lawyering of narrative storytelling defense skill and create an imaginative world in which acquittal was the least plausible. The lawyer implicitly challenged the prosecutor's central argument that he could speak for itself. A narrative expands possibilities remaining anchored in the reality of the evidence. And I'm a character in a story that I didn't write. Two options. Do the mass circumstantial evidence plus which your prejudice at 25 to life. My innocence doesn't factor into the equation. Beyond a shadow of a doubt, but what does that mean when the jury's already decided the verdict before I walk in the courtroom? The minute they read my last name, this is what they tell me that I don't stand a chance. They pray on fear to box us into the cycle. We were going to create the collective action problems inherent in the system. Prosecutors have more resources to get long conviction from a few cases than to go to a court, which raises the average conviction length and subsequently makes plea bargaining more likely. Full trial for defense will clock, course, enforce minimum prison sentence, reducing leverage for prosecutors having the release of any defendant's choice for misdemeanors. Fitz 09. Plea bargaining saves resources for a prosecutor, which openly drives sentences up and lots of large expenditures on the occasional case where the defendant will not bargain. This system research strengthens prosecutors' standing increases his or her bargaining position in other cases by giving defendant an unrealistically high impression of length of sentences in cases that do go to trial. These induce defendants to accept the bargain by setting artificially high standard for outcomes. Defendants act collectively, each demanding a full trial. Effect the clock court system leading to minimum prison sentences in terms of man year, which situation would lead to the release of many defendants. And recognition of non-traditional spaces is key. This means the courtroom is key. Exclusion from traditional academia disrupts in non-conventional spaces. Cruz 3. Theory of body assembly entity, a cosmic framework whose interests lie outside our social environments, and this is not affected by the workings of our everyday material realities. The boundaries between political, personal, and political are demarcated not only in evaluation of their validity as narrative truth, but also in a potential to erode foundations of the society. Cultural knowledge depends. Scholar in position of the brown and lesbian body is not only disruptive, but also excessive in its disorderly movements and conduct. I think for us, the custodians of normality and understanding more than the excessiveness of a body, our research and narratives called the messy text of research and writing narratives of women of color are considered too corporal, too colored, and sometimes too queer to be considered published. Black and boundaries since regulation become political borders, leading there to marginalize. This is for scholars who read these texts to comment and produce theory in non-traditional spaces. This I affirm. Also, in that last card of theory, sorry about that.
Yeah. Wait, so you didn't read the last part?
No, the doc that I said, I don't think has the very last part that I read.
Oh, okay.
Right? The cruiser?
No, definitely.
I'm assuming that's right now. Sorry.
Okay, yeah.
There
you
go.
No, it should be fine. It's just kind of loud.
It's just like the very last one.
Okay, that's cool. Alright, is everyone ready?
Yeah.
Is winning that plea bargaining should exist a condition for voting next?
The plea bargaining should exist? Yeah.
Okay. So, if I win, plea bargaining should exist. Is there any other alternate way the app can win?
I mean, theoretically, there's pre-cut impacts to the app's methodology of engaging through narratives. Like,
are those aside from winning that plea bargaining is good?
Yeah.
Or is bad?
It's like, it's using the narrative to inform your decision on plea bargaining. That's the offense for the app and breaking down traditional academic
Is that narrative itself an independent reason to vote app?
Yeah. Like, it's the methodology of the app is a reason to vote app because the pre-fiat impact is breaking away from, like, traditional concepts of knowledge.
And does
it's
the
something
app,
that the app does.
Does the app defend a policy action?
Yeah.
It does?
The app is for rights now.
It defends the policy implementation of, why, of like, it defends...
Oh,
that,
it
like,
defends abolishing plea bargaining, yeah.
By, like, a state agent?
Yeah.
Okay. So it defends that in the United States... Will you defend, like, the United States federal government does?
Yeah, I'll defend Horace.
Okay. And you'll defend a policy action. I just
yeah.
want to like, make
Yes, I will defend a policy action.
You'll defend that the United States federal government
yeah.
abolishes plea bargaining in the United States criminal justice system.
Yes.
Okay. Why is the narrative a reason for you to vote F on that?
Yeah, so that's coming out of like the pre-fiat impacts of the app, and it's coming out of the Bernal card and the analytic underneath it, which is talking about... it's talking specifically about the way that we engage in educational research, and like debate in itself is like educational research, like we're researching about topics and things like that. It's saying the way that we engage in educational research needs to be fundamentally like focused on engaging in that research through the perspectives of minority groups to add context, because otherwise when you engage in adversarial spaces and you just like yell things at each other, it doesn't actually create any learning, it doesn't actually create any policies that care about people, that care about like the actual conditions or realities that people live in. You need to use narratives to add context to the things that you advocate for and to make sure that the things that you're advocating for are things that are actually going to like help specific groups.
Why does the specific narrative of the AC warrant why plea bargaining ought to be abolished?
No, that's coming, the reason that it's pre-fiat and not just like specifically talk and not just like something that I'm doing is that it's talking about why I as a person and my personal narrative, it's adding that kind of context to the AF and the argumentation that the AF is doing and the kind of research and research project that the AF is. Like that's why it's
but
a
But why is that
a
reason
impact.
For why plea bargaining is
Because my personal experience as a Chicana woman has informed my position in the world in a way that this is how I perceive the data and this is how I argue the data that I've come across.
Okay.
Like, it's not an argument of, like, you need to have experienced plea bargaining in order to come to this idea. It's about this idea of, like, cultural intuition and, like, the cultures that you grew up with and the things that you've been subjected to inform your position in the world and how you interpret data. And that needs to be, like, considered.
I have 2 minutes and 21 seconds left. The order is too often case. Same as speech talk. One of the off cases in the NC talks about specific issues of like child sexual assault. Is that okay with everyone?
First off, critiquing indulgence, sentimentality, grievability based on reflection, structural pain, insurance, attachments, and political affective economy reinforces liberalism as a ability to compartmentalize, recreate suffering, and while generating cruelly optimistic attachment, victimhood, strict 14, in the public sphere of pain isn't becoming the primary obsession, narratives of personal trauma, public intelligibility, public movements, race, consciousness, excluded forms of life, and the critical discourses shed light on social violence movement, expanded public recognition, injury, changing scope, and intelligibility, co-op, identitarian politics, and doing much of capitalization of pain as necessary to politics or community. The politics of the affective dictate the development of the political and sentimental sentimentals and hold the subjectivities, granted recognition, pain, and looking human universal capacity, some of the sentiment linkage was formed in national history, successful incorporation of our set subject national project. This connection of pain of the national nation subjectivity led to the public sphere of the becoming a set of intimate affective exchange, invisible in the proliferation, traumatized self-hood. We see a collusion between liberal capitalism forming the mass entertainment individuals, therapies, and turns case liberalism exists a model for victimhood, inevitable can't basis, exclusion, identity can't be compartmentalized. Evidence sent with liberal peace, predicate elimination, and difference, more words declared to achieve as a project of removing or complete the land. And then fought the between modalities of left liberalism gains mastery by opposing unification species. What becomes an interest emerges in liberatory liberal imagination, the threat of violence and sanction against us. You have music community doing what's necessary to have global species necessity requires the violence against political difference through discourse of practical reasons, qualification, one is capable of triggering a barrier to domain of life, not under powers control, one must live in the one must die, constantly redefine threshold of life within a sense of limiting rate of logically important ones excluded, and the world values both we are debated best cultivate subjectivity. Now, the negative to embrace an actual ecology rather than focus on victimhood, minority strategy, and versus collective coming towards deviance. Understanding that the world through African enables coming together and move past human subjectivity, they have an ecological connection together. This molecular structure connects it in abstract subjectivity and material progress, and this is of African in the material world. McCormick on end. The loose points of becoming a directly affected real bodies of real situation, not philosophical, the focus on experience, sexuality, ecology, that involves tactics and methods and impossible concretism, and mobilization practices, such as an animal human square, mobilization practice, deterioration, indestructibly actual and theoretical politically, the body able to be heard to deprive a diet at the point at which the subjectivity of the Hansen is maintained by philosophy's material vitalistic philosophy. Must colonize a plane of self-maintenance and located in the flesh autonomy, defined legally owning their body is what we must refuse in the flesh of molecular in a political assemblage, like molecule in a pack such as pack feminism, and pack anti-racism and career rights, because the flesh in which use a minority status, suffering death has been experienced, racial other murder, career denied rights, becoming not victims of tactical entry points, majority system must be used to focus on change. We must not take care of martyr ourselves, assessing or become the not and being the ethics demands that we seek a decentral moral or majority which oppress but also actively affect single instances suffering in life. Now second off. Counterplan result. Plea bargaining shall be abolished in all cases except those regarding child sexual assault. To clarify, we advocate the entirety of the affirmative except for in this specific instance. Now, trials ensure psychological violence against survivors, sexual abuse, no recourse, no solvency, deaths, and survivors. One, the other child, they say, can't win on 9-9. Bracket victims, survivor, for the survivors of child sexual assault, abuse becomes a trauma aside from crime itself and trauma associated with having testified about testifying and being subject to cross examination inherently intrusive and traumatic. That reopens wounds if defensive refuse to plea bargaining more. Will be focused on testifying, which make it less likely to come forward, more harm, pressures, conflicts, and society can want to be defended in plea bargaining. First, plea bargaining saves survivors from having public relief and a nightmare. Second is that chance of conviction of 50-50 best measure is likely to acquit the defendant in such a case of plea bargaining. Yes, the defendant going to the counseling for the conditions and access of vulnerable children and providing records. Now there's two impacts. One is that outweighs relief, trauma is crazy, irreversible psychological harm, effect 1,000 OD and 89. Sexual assault, legal proceeding reflexive special stresses can slow. Course of normal cognitive measure, developmental regression appears that number of studies examine children's testimony. Testimony is criminal court associated with the immediate as well as the lasting distress that happened month of testimony. Children manifest as different depression, anxiety, psychological symptoms. Second is that it also turns you off on a methodological level. Even if you say that it's uncertain engagement and certain things like narrativity is good, you should ask yourself what other narratives and what the implication of this advocacy has on the narratives of people outside of this realm, which co-opts all their framing. They say that we should embrace an epistemic perspective that understands individuals who fall outside of the scope of cited literature. Obviously, the affirmative by engaging in a single narrative fails to account for the implications of that advocacy on other potential narratives, which means that it still turns the case on a pre-field level. Now, the case overview on the method one, over all of their arguments just collapse to consequentialism. 8 points, that's a question of the implication of their advocacy that they defend. Even if your specific narrative justifies why plea bargaining is specifically bad, all their arguments just boil down to consequential justifications for why plea bargaining leads to negative consequences to individuals. And B point is that consequences themselves inform narratives, i.e. the consequence of policies and how they can structurally coerce individuals, inform whether or not new narratives of trauma are created, which means that the affirmative would still be net worse in terms of an advocacy question. Now also second is performativity. Also now overview on the method. One, performativity is not auto win for the affirm, proving that their practice itself is dangerous. Also subjectivity would still preclude on this question. A point is that it's a question of how subjects themselves orient themselves towards this specific narratives. And B point is a question of how other people and liberalism are able to co-opt it, which means that the critique is still a hard question. Second term, yes, even if intersectional powers are identity, but narrativity replies the question. Instead, we should depoliticize identity. Brown 96, if discourse domination is set for counter sales, this tool of emancipation carries its own techniques of education, conversion, non-domestic origin, tendencies to establish regular norms, powers, one-size disciplinary power, feeds the powers of men to starve in. These surface spaces of trivial, rendering political persons, passion, and leaves injurious powers untouched. These production of truth, the rare capacity to change us injurious histories, instigate regulation of those life, depoliticizing their conditions, which also specifically is weighed against their Christian evidence. So, a point is that how it because it proves that a focus on narrativity within specific spaces still allows for those narratives to be co-opted by liberalism. Second is that the critique would still outweigh on this question specifically because it answers the question of how multiple alternate structural factors are able to co-opt and engage in those narratives, which means that even in the third is that this argument says that it begs the question whether or not debate itself is a non-contemporary context in which individuals engage in narrativity, but the still not evidence is very clear about how debating in terms of narrativity is still comparatively worse. Now, also turn narrativity a central aspect of plea bargaining. Main source of plea bargaining portray conflict because it's not yet resolved the reflection of relationship between actions and stories they tell. Narratives are a resource of plea bargaining. Plea bargaining is a way of rendering subject substantive justice. The case characteristics and legal manners are talked in a way of being a narrative and narrative structure. Usually narrative internal narratives are elicited and pieced together through a question and answer series where plea bargaining stories and hold more spontaneity and uninterrupted, which also outweighs all their half arguments because their methodology itself begs the question of whether or not we also the methodology assumes that narrativity is something that is important. But if I hold that the structure of plea bargaining is something that allows for more individual narratives to come to light and allows individuals to engage in their own personal narratives, and that means that it appeals to the highest level of the framework and still outweighs the sophisticated evidence. Now, also trial narratives are worse. The jury will always prefer testimony of mainstream powerful agents already marginalized and seem less reliable, so plea bargaining is the best shot of the system against them. And also, use of narratives forces narrative coherence, which forces you to render violence against traumatic experience through absolutely violent means, but there are one. Narrative coherence is for political responsibility, ethical resource, acceptable limits of knowledgeability, one holds person accountable life narrative to require falsification of that life in any certain conception. If we require this, some tells the story reason why their life is taken path, this has to require violence. The way in which we are interrupted, alternating, not fully recoverable ourselves, indicates the way we are ethically implicated lives of others, would cut the card at others, which also should be weighed specifically against the Hollow 9 evidence. We claim specifically all of their evidence about narrativity being good, but just begs the question of how others engage and interpret those narratives, which means that narratives don't exist in a specific monocosm of individuals just saying their narrative and then existing there, but rather it begs the question of how other structures interact with those narratives, are able to co-opt them in violent ways, which means their methods still work.
Alright, you want me to resend the new speech doc?
What did you say?
I'm going to resend the new speech doc.
Okay. So you're basically starting from. So the K is making the argument, right, that the narratives are sentimental and they focus on grieving, and that like reinforces liberalism, we compartmentalize suffering, right?
I mean, that's like part of the K, the strict evidence.
Yeah.
That's what we're thinking. Yeah.
Cool. What's the what's like the alternative, right, for me and like for engaging in my identity? Because like the story of the narrative, right, is specifically that like, so how do I overcome the fact that my narrative has not been accessible to me?
The critique?
What is my opportunity for writing that?
My argument is that the critique alternative, if anything, would just be comparatively better on that issue, right? Because if, rather than engaging in an abstract narrative that attempts for outside recognition, the alternative indicates that a reliance on victimhood is worse, and instead we should engage on things like such as affective coalitions, and how an appeal to individual autonomy is still worse, even though, albeit it's through narrativity. That attempt for individual autonomy is worse and fails to recognize how individuals can engage in their own politics that is itself redeeming against like symbolic structures.
So like, what does the app look like if it's not engaging in narratives?
The affirmative looks like a play with like the categories of flesh that attempt to rupture in, or the reasons why those narratives, like certain narratives, are crushed in the first place. Instead of individuals trying to, basically like that. It's like its own individually redeeming politics, right? Rather than a politics that is bound by a narrative in which the narrative seeks some sort of external recognition, which the strict evidence says is always co-opted by liberalism, the alternative engages in a play with certain categories that allow for individuals to engage in their own personal politics.
So why does the existence of my narrative in the app have to be seeking external recognition? Why can't it be me an act of rejecting what I have been expected to do for my entire life? Why is it not for me? Why is it for you?
Well, no, the argument is that that is just an incorrect interpretation of how the methodology of using narratives has been co-opted by liberalism. The strict 09, strict 14 evidence just very clearly says that while in the abstract, narratives may be individuals attempting to come to solace with their own identity, the fact is that when you engage in those narratives, and what happens is that when they're brought to the public sphere, it allows for things like forces of capital to use them and like force them into like a specific identitarian politics of intelligibility that allows for liberalism to do things like compartmentalize those narratives into things that are just used for consumption and fail to acknowledge that.
So basically, my narrative is always going to be for consumption, so I should never say it, right? Like, I should never actually engage in my own identity,
because
I'm always something that's going to be.
Not that you should never engage in your own identity, but not instead that your identity is not something that can be compartmentalized into a single narrative that it requires sentiment for, right? Instead, your identity is something that is built by numerous affective forces and numerous structures and how they interlock with
each
other.
Okay, redefine affect
identities.
For me.
What?
Redefine affect for me and how it's different.
Affect is an individual's own like emotional response to the external world and their own ability to expose and externalize that emotional response in its own like creative way.
Are you okay with flexible?
Yeah.
What makes the aff not affective? Why am I not like creatively like expressing how I perceive and interact with the world?
Because you can think that it's a form. It is like it is a type of affect, right? Because affect is a very general term, and there's
what makes
types
it a
of
bad
affect.
Affect? Is it just the additional
unproductive, links? Right? However, the type of affect that the affirmative seeks is one that looks to the public sphere and looks to specific like exchange of affect and the proliferation of a narrative of selfhood that itself allows for consumption of it and reaffirms liberalism.
first indictment is that my performance isn't good subjectivity, but my performance is inherently subjectivity, and it's the best way to embrace subjectivity. This is coming out of the Bernal card. The Bernal card is specifically telling you that we each have our own ways that we investigate the world. We each have our own cultural intuition, and it's built up specifically by the way that we've experienced the world and the things that we have experienced. This is subjectivity defined, and saying that the only way to actually engage in subjectivity and create good scholarship based on that subjectivity is to look at individual communities, to actually look at the way the policies affect them and look from their own personal viewpoint instead of looking at an objective perspective of just literally looking at like your post-fiat impacts and post-fiat evidence. It's actually using a narrative sensibility to guide the way that you come to conclusions on educational research. If we're looking at the role of validity, who embraces subjectivity, the affirmative is the only one that does that, and the only one that is actually accepting of other subjective viewpoints. And then you're going to go on to the rest of the framing on the Miranda card, which is specifically contextualizing why we need narratives to actually create a guide for social movements and social movements in the future that actually like, respect the social positions of people. And then he tries to like create all these critiques on narratives, and on the Holocaust he says the trials are worse, but one, this is just untrue. The Holocaust is justifying why we can actually use narratives as a way to engage with trials in a way that is positive, in a way that builds something, in a way that affects the world, in a way that actually allows people to actually engage with the system that they're in instead of having it just be subjected to them. He has to say that trials are worse, that our narratives are going to be co-opted, but I'm going to get on that on the K. And then he said that he again, it always for co-option, but I'll get on that on the K. And he says that engaging, that like he uses the Maynard card to try to get like a turn on it, and he specifically says that like this exists in plea bargaining, but one, I read the Maynard card, it's specifically talking about sentence bargaining, and I think a type of plea bargaining that's literally the least common type of plea bargaining it uses. It also talks about fictional narratives that aren't real and are used for prosecutor leverage. The Maynard card is not the position or the methodology of the app. You're going to be accepting the evidence that goes clean unrefuted that's coming out of Giroux and Savitsky and French. That's contextualizing how I'm actually deconstructing the neoliberal state by getting rid of plea bargaining, which is like a neoliberal process. It causes us to investigate a cost-benefit analysis that directly devalues and dehumanizes minority bodies. That means you're always going to be voting out on the post-fiat world. But even if you look at like the counterplan in the K, part of the counterplan isn't actually combated with the act of will, because the wording of the plan like this is combined with the whole where the counterplan is people, and it's actually combated enough to functionally combated, because otherwise it's not seeing that from the app, it's not actually combated, and the firm result in the counterplan is not actually combated, because it's at the resolution accepting cases of the proper way to write would be reading every category of crime that plea bargaining would be abolished, and not like the vice versa. So literally don't care about the counterplan perm, and like the perm is like the counterplan is the perm, because he's not textually competitive. Then you go on to the K. One, he tells you in the strict card that I allow for the consumption of my narrative because I'm looking at sentimentality, but this is specifically a turn. He literally links into the framing of the app that's telling you that for my entire life I've been told that I should be scared to embrace in my identity because people will use it against me. That's the reason that I haven't been able to engage in it in my entire life. The point of the app is to radically embrace it in the face of people telling me that I can't or I shouldn't or it would be bad for me. The only thing that like the strict card says is that like identity politics are something bad because it's always going to be looking at this idea of sentimentality and suffering, but he ignores the fact that like I'm not giving you my narrative of suffering, I'm not giving you my narrative of victimhood, I'm not giving you anything, I am doing this for me, it's my engagement with my identity because I haven't been allowed to, and crossed by the Cruz card. Cruz card justifies specifically why we need to have this engagement in unconventional spaces as opposed to something like literature or writing that isn't adversarial. And then you're going to go on to, further on to the Evans card, which is literally the impact that it's using this model for victimhood, but literally he says that the liberal method is the unification of species, but that's not what the methodology of the app is advocating for. The methodology of the app is advocating for embracing our own individual social location, not it's embracing the fact that we are not all the same. It's resenting unification of species. It tells me I am no different from you, even though you live a life of privilege that I have not had. That's the entire point of the app. That's what the app is doing. It's justified through literally all of the framing cards that I read that goes clear. Unrefuted, and then even if you look at the role of ballot of looking at cultivating subjectivity, you're still going to be affirming because I'm the only one that actually does that and engages in subjectivity. I'm still avid, I'm still creatively engaging in my own identity, but I'm doing it through the app.
Okay, can you send, what was the perm you read on the counter?
I can just, sorry, my voice is gone. I can copy paste it.
Okay, just send me the speech doc.
Yeah. Is it okay if it's not in a speech doc because it's with like.
Just send it, yeah.
Okay,
so. Right, I have 2 minutes and 21 seconds. Starting grab now. Why is it counterplan? The app defense plea bargaining ought to be abolished in the United States, right?
Mm-hmm.
Why is it not textually competitive?
So textually competitive is like the way that you phrase a counterplan. It's just like a poorly written counterplan text.
Why?
Like to be textually competitive, it can't be the res like with something on the end of it. It has to actually like I say the proper way to write it, like in what I sent you, but
okay.
It's just not like definitionally it's not textually competitive.
Why? The counterplan says
like it's not textually competitive.
It says
like textually competitive is different from functionally competitive.
Okay.
And even like the functional competitiveness is like
is